members for inviting me to speak on behalf of Simon today. As you can see, Simon is both medical director at Wildmouth, which is an assessment and rehab unit for people living with HIV and HIV-associated neurocognitive disorder. He's also a consultant HIV physician at Barts Health, which is a large acute centre and also local to Wildmouth. As you can see, I'll be presenting on Simon's behalf HIV and ageing data from the UK perspective. Okay. Here's some slides from Public Health England. Just as you can see, the blue line there demonstrating a fairly dramatic rise in new diagnoses, then a slight overall fall occurring in more recent years. And of particular note is the crossing line on the curves for new AIDS diagnoses and deaths. And that does indicate more deaths from non-AIDS morbidities, which is obviously something the speakers have already touched on today. Trends in people diagnosed with HIV by age group, again from Public Health England. I think one of the things a lot of people again will be aware of is that increasing numbers of people at older age are being diagnosed and are therefore accessing care. In 2012, the most recent data, because obviously it's 1 year retrospective, shows us that one in four adults were accessing care at an age of 50 or over, and that's compared to one in eight in 2003. So in a decade or so, we're seeing a dramatic increase in the number of people accessing care at an older age. And we see relatively stable numbers in the 25 to 34 age group, but increasing numbers in 35 to 49 and 50 plus. And we're also seeing a gradual increase in numbers for the 50 plus years and over group. So they comprise about a quarter of the group, all of those accessing care. So we can see it as a growing problem, and that's getting bigger over time. And obviously that's both people living longer with HIV, which is obviously a success, mostly getting through ARVs, but also people being diagnosed with HIV and having to support people living with HIV. More slides for us to digest. So we say we know people are surviving with HIV, and we know they're living longer, but obviously that's not the whole story. The evidence on this slide confirms an increasing incidence of new HIV diagnoses in the 50 plus age group. And we see those diagnoses are increasing, and this group estimated that approximately 50% of adults were contracting HIV later in life.
Sorry, I missed that.
So it's not just that. That older adults are not being diagnosed, and obviously that is likely to be part of it. But it's also that perhaps something about their activity and their behaviour, which changes demographically, societally, are influencing that rate of diagnosis. Excuse me. So maybe that's sexual activity later in life, continuing into older age, and perhaps socially that's a change that we still maybe find unexpected, although why we should, who knows. It's interesting that the findings of around new diagnoses are true for both the heterosexual and the homosexual population. So it's interesting that it works across different populations. And it's also around sort of individual factors, obviously, but again, as I say, social factors as well. Changing relationships, marriage changes, you know, different social expectations around behaviors. Attributes of late diagnosis, and as most people in this room will know, a late diagnosis is if when you're diagnosed your CD4 count is at a level of 350 or less. This is selected by Simon, because obviously we need to ask what's the impact of being older and being HIV positive. And we know that late diagnosis is the most important predictor of both morbidity and mortality amongst those with HIV. And we also know that for people aged 50 and over, they're much more likely to be diagnosed late. And again, that's also likely, no evidence would suggest that's likely to be because of individual personal factors, but likely also to be because of healthcare factors and maybe perceptions of healthcare professionals or services that people may be accessing. one-year motility amongst adults and diagnosed by CD4 CAM. And again, I'm not expecting you to look at all these things in great detail, but we know that CD4 counter diagnosis is important because in the context of being late, at an older age, there's an increased mortality rate. And within 1 year of diagnosis, there's a fivefold increase of mortality in the 50 plus age group. And even where HIV diagnosis is timely, people have older people have an increased risk of mortality, and that's obviously very important. Okay, so having presented very quickly some demographic details, I'm now going to move on to exploring the interplay between HIV and ageing. As others have mentioned, this very recent work by Bunting et al. Demonstrates that the immune effects of HIV and of ageing look remarkably similar. It makes it doubly important for us to look at these aspects in conjunction. And again, as Colin indicated and other speakers yesterday spoke about, we need to think about comorbidities in the era of highly active antiretroviral therapy, many of which we're very familiar with. So what impact do we see on the ground here? We know that these multiple comorbidities exist. This might mean that people are accessing care from lots of different teams. How well do those teams work together? Is the fragmentation, things again, as Colin said. It might be that people are working in silos. We also have to think about what are the interactions between the different elements of care that people are accessing, and try and make sure that they're not sort of banging up against one another, but they are working in collaboration, and that can be very difficult. The same information may not be being shared with all the different teams. I think of all the points that when Simon and I were discussing this, he particularly wanted me to draw out is to think about frailty. And again, mentioned by yourself. So what might we see as a clinical picture when we're thinking about frailty? I suppose Simon and I were talking about it and saying, so perhaps that's the aspect of bouncing back from something. So, you know, someone might have an event, an older person living with HIV might have an event happen to them, and perhaps firstly, that event may have a more significant impact upon them than perhaps upon someone who's younger, might set them back further, but also might take them longer time to come forward, to bounce back from that, if you like. So they recover from the event at a slower rate and less successfully. Again, I'm not going to dwell on this too long, because time is passing, but again, very important to look at lots of different impacts, all interacting together, not one thing in isolation, but they're all as contributing there to premature ageing. Again, this will stop talk, but what we need to say here is obviously this is THT, National Study of HIV and Ageing, and it basically the key message here is respondents are reporting a high number of comorbidities, and any of these, certainly from a therapy and rehab perspective, can have a potential negative impact upon everyday abilities and also upon function. Okay. So we have some quotes there, but again, I think I'm not going to obviously read them aloud to you, but the key aspects here, that again, I think are just constant themes: economic hardship, HIV-related stigma, mental health issues and difficulties, and also that we're increasingly seeing as clinicians difficulties associated with living, not difficulties associated with dying. And that's really key for the people we work with. Here, again, touching on Kelly's work and other work and people here in the room, uncertainty, massive issue for people. Double diagnoses, namely HIV and cancer, HIV and cognitive impairment, and the interaction of things like employment, immigration, finances, with HIV. This is a quick picture of Mildmay Old on the left and Mildmay New. We moved into this building literally a few weeks ago. And for those that don't know Mildmay, we're an assessment and rehab unit for adults living with HIV and HIV-associated cognitive impairment. Simon has been in post at Mildmay since 2005. He's worked at Mildmay in various guises and roles before then. I've worked at Mildmay since 1996. And obviously over that time, our population and the needs and the services have have changed. So we now commonly see people, rather than having repeat admissions throughout maybe a year or a few years, we see people often on a one-off basis. But obviously I work there for a period of time, as has Simon. We increasingly see people maybe representing at one of these 10 years. So it's not a one-off event and then issues are resolved, but we're not seeing obviously the repeat rapid opportunistic infection related deterioration that we were in the past. Okay. So what do we see? Increasing age, increasing neurological disability, increasing comorbidity, and also we're seeing people at an assessment and rehab setting that have been lost to follow-up at an acute centre service, and also we're seeing new neurological symptoms. And our spread of ages, from 18 to 84. So again, we're seeing an older population in the same way that some of those public health slides show for us. Okay. So again, I'm not going to dwell on this, I know time's short. So we're just talking again about the interplay of physical, psychological and social aspects, and many of us aware how those impact upon function and performance, and also the cumulative effect of a number of these issues. I'm going to finish with a quick case study. This is a gentleman who was 73 years of age on admission to Martinet. And he was admitted for rehab following acute hospital admission, and he presented with self-neglect, chronic cough and poor adherence with care and with medication. And also I've noticed that this gentleman had actually been diagnosed 5 years previously, but lost to follow-up. So here on the left, we see some aspects that are known to have an impact upon the brain. And on the right, we see aspects related to cardiovascular risk with particularly his removal of his spleen, perhaps having also an impact on his immune function. And really these elements are here just to highlight to us all the complexity of care, the needs and the assessment needs and the rehab needs of this person, obviously in conjunction with his older age. Again, you can read the... You can have a look at these for yourself. But you can see from the left to the right, we have quite a significant change. So additional to this clinical picture, he also received intravenous fluids during his admission, and that was due to his limited intake of food and fluids. And he also required earlier and sort of midway into his admission physical support from rehab assistants, nursing staff on the ward, and also verbal prompts for eating and drinking. But what we did see, and what we do see obviously, is through effective antiretroviral therapy, the changes in CD4 and viral load enable assessment and rehab to take place. That's our bedrock. And he was discharged to nursing home placement. And obviously that may by some not be seen as a success. He didn't return home to the community. He didn't return home to independent living. I guess we've got to ask ourselves how realistic might that be anyway, with or without the context of HIV and all those other comorbidities. But as on a positive, on a constructive note, on discharge from mild May, he was more independent than on admission. And he was able to participate in certain daily living activities that were previously possible for him. And I would also suggest that his quality of life was higher as well. He engaged more in social activities. He had more things that he could participate in that gave him enjoyment. However limited that might have been, whether that was, you know, going to the cafe or watching the television or looking at a newspaper, those were the things he selectively wanted to do. Okay, a couple more slides. This is from some work Simon presented at AIDS Impact, as you can see. Myself and the speech and language therapist also contributed to this. And it's using two outcome measures that we formerly used at MildMed. So the Norfolk Park Dependency Scale and the Health of the Nation Outcome Scale for acquired brain injury. So we're using a basket of outcome measures to look at impact of assessment of rehab therapy over time. And these tools are only one way of measuring outputs, obviously. The Norfolk Park Dependency Scale is predominantly physical, and the HONOS is a predominantly cognitive and psychosocial scale. And we took an approach of a basket of measures because we felt that one tool didn't capture all the things we needed to see. And we hope to publish that in the future with some additional data on it. Okay. This is my final slide. So, just to familiarise ourselves with some of the challenges we have with ageing and HIV. So we've got the comorbidities, on either an automatic guarantee, they will recover to 100% of functional to their previous level. So we know we need a range of clinical skills, and we know we need multidisciplinary work. We also know we need resources, and resources take time and they take money, and that's challenges we're all facing. And it's also important to note that, and to understand for our commissioners and for ourselves, that however great the service, the impact of rehab will be variable. Not everybody is going to reach the same level and not necessarily attain the full independence necessary. But we certainly hope to see an increase in functional quality of life and well-being.